Hello again. In this section of the course, I will speak about conflict analysis. As we discussed in the introductory segment, I call something a conflict when some of the people involved feel they have to struggle against others to meet their needs. Here I'm focusing on how we analyze conflicts. Some of the parts of analyzing conflicts come straight from the definition I've offered. We analyze who are the people, how are they involved, how do they feel, how do they see things, how do they struggle. What are their tactics? Whom do they struggle against? Why do they struggle? My mentor, Dr. Christopher Mitchell, who's an emeritus professor here at George Mason University and is one of the early pioneers in the field of conflict analysis and resolution, taught me a simple framework for analyzing conflicts, which he calls Spitzero, S-P-I-T-C-E-R-O-W. That stands for sources, parties, interests, tactics, change over time, escalation, resources, outcomes, and winners. I've noticed it can be very useful to go through this framework with each of the parties in a conflict. Ask them what they see as the sources, parties, interests, tactics, change over time, escalation, resources, outcomes, and potential winners in a conflict. Understanding how many parties to a conflict see the conflict helps get a really clear picture of the multifaceted conflict. It might even be that there isn't one conflict if the parties have different definitions of the problem. By clarifying what the problem or problems are, then we are better set up to solve them. Let me give you an example. There is a conflict between Georgians and South Ossetians. In August 2008, there was fighting between Georgian, South Ossetian, and Russian troops. Now, South Ossetians and Russian troops are controlling an area that Russia, Nicaragua, and a few other countries have recognized as an independent new country, South Ossetia. But most international states recognize that area as part of the country, the Republic of Georgia. Let's see how the Spitzero model helps us make sense of this conflict. Georgians might see the source of the conflict in Russian imperialism in the South Caucasus region. South Ossetians might see the source of the conflict in Georgian imperialism. Georgians might see Georgia and Russia as the main parties, while South Ossetians would see South Ossetians and Georgians as the main parties. Now let's consider interests. For Georgians, there's a strong interest in territorial integrity and in independence from Russian influence. For South Ossetians, there's a strong interest in independence from Georgian influence and in self-determination. The tactics the parties use now are different too. Georgians are reaching out to engage the South Ossetians in various ways of rebuilding relationships. South Ossetians are cautious about engaging. Now consider time. As time goes on, South Ossetians are adapting to life with very little connection with Georgians. Both sides are becoming more frustrated with the long period of time since the war and little progress in negotiations. Time is changing the conflict. This is a conflict that did not start only in 2008. Rather, there had been fighting in the 1990s too. 2008 was a major escalation of the conflict. What will allow a de-escalation? Let's look at resources. Russia is providing substantial aid to South Ossetia, including a strong military presence. While Georgians look at the Russian troops as occupiers, South Ossetians see them as a protective resource. Another resource is relationships between the parties. The relationship between South Ossetians and President Saakashvili in Georgia was far from good. Now, in 2013, there is a new South Ossetian leadership and also a new Georgian leadership. These shifts offer moments for potential changes in the ways the conflict develops. Outcomes. We're not at the stage of seeing outcomes yet. Georgians and South Ossetians will have to work those out over many years. My hope is that they will do so peacefully without further war deaths, and that in the end, the real winners will be Georgian and South Ossetian people. If it comes to a place where one side seems to be the total winner, and the other the total loser, my guess is that that place will not be the end state. Both Georgian and South Ossetian people are proud and persistent, and they will continue struggling until they feel an outcome is fair and meets their needs. That's one example of a conflict. What conflicts do you know well? In the resources section of this course, you will find a worksheet for analyzing a conflict according to the Spitzero model. Give it a try, and then please also reflect on what is missing from this model. Every analytical tool helps us focus on parts of something by leaving out other aspects. What is left out when you analyze a conflict you know well using the Spitzero model? Notice these things and make a list. You might create another model that focuses on different parts. Then, see if that model is useful. And don't forget to try to use these models, whether Spitzero or your own, to learn how others see a conflict. If you belong to one group and are in conflict with another group, see if you can learn to understand how the other group would use one of these conflict analysis frameworks to make sense of the conflict from their perspective. I'd like also to introduce a basic model of conflict escalation and de-escalation. This appeared in Chris Mitchell's The Structure of International Conflict, and with more detail in Michael Lund's Preventive Diplomacy. As you see in the diagram, conflicts can be seen with varied intensity over time. First, we see latent conflict. Then it emerges through conflict escalation, possibly into destructive conflict. Then, through conflict de-escalation, we can hope to reach post-conflict peace building. Anywhere along this spectrum, conflict resolution processes can be helpful. If we look at the Georgian South Ossetian conflict example, we can see time periods when a resolution might have been reached before the August 2008 war. There were periods when the conflict had escalated into fighting in the 1990s, but then had de-escalated into a period of constructive, but not conclusive, negotiations. Unfortunately, that conflict then re-escalated. How would you draw the escalation and de-escalation dynamics of a conflict you know well? How is conflict analysis useful? I see conflict analysis as an essential part of conflict resolution practice. In working in conflict resolution practices, we constantly analyze the changing conflicts. The resulting understanding of the conflicts help us shape our conflict resolution practice to be more effective in moving towards agreements that satisfy everyone involved. Many of the models used in conflict analysis were created by practitioners to help them shape their work. Many of the early practitioners of conflict resolution noticed three fundamental parts of conflicts and of the party's satisfaction with the outcome of conflicts. They used different words for these three, but they focused around process, substance, and relationship. Chris Moore wrote an early book on mediation called The Mediation Process, in which he noted parties and mediation processes like to be satisfied with process, substance, and relationship. We can call that the satisfaction triangle. Chris Mitchell and Johann Galtung and others have worked with similar groups of three aspects of conflict. See what precise focus helps you analyze the conflicts you know. Maybe it's the attitudes, the behavior, and the contradiction that help you make sense of the conflicts you work with. Adapt the model as you find it useful. If we return briefly to the Georgian South Ossetian conflict example, I'll focus on the process, substance, and relationship aspects of the conflict. The process unfortunately included a tragic war in which people on both sides were wounded and killed. The process has not yet allowed people to visit the graves of their family members on the other side of the conflict line, nor to find all the missing persons or identify the unidentified bodies left behind after the war. The process led to many wounds. Those wounds influence the relationship aspects of the conflict. Georgians tell of a history in which South Ossetians and Georgians live together in peace. They feel good personal relationships with many South Ossetians. While South Ossetians do acknowledge individual friendships with individual Georgians, the experience of the war remains a barrier to any quick return to that friendly past. Finally, the substance of the conflict could be summarized as territorial integrity versus self-determination. In the eyes of the South Ossetians, they see that matter as settled. They declared independence, and Russia recognized them. But in the eyes of Georgia, that matter is not settled. And as I noted before, if one party sees a conflict, then there is one, even if the other party doesn't see it that way. Let's look more at the substance-process-relationship model. In American culture, we often focus only on the substance of a conflict. We ask, what is it about? What are the options for settling the specific issues that are under dispute? So for Americans, the simple model of process, substance, and relationship is a good reminder to look also at process and relationship. Who has been engaged in the process of discussions on these issues? How could the processes be more effective and more satisfying to all the parties? What are the relationships between the parties? How could these relationships be more satisfying? My experience indicates we can't go too far in agreeing either new processes or substantive settlements or rebuilding relationships if we aren't also making progress on the other two aspects. In other words, we can't rebuild a relationship fully if we don't build new processes and agree the substantive matters in dispute. Similarly, we can't agree those substantive matters entirely until we also develop new processes and relationships on which those can be based. Try thinking about the process, substance, and relationship aspects of a conflict you know well. As you do this, do you see areas where progress could be made on one of those aspects? What could help rebuild a good process? For example, countries might agree to reestablish diplomatic relations. What could help address a difficult relationship? For example, artists might celebrate each other's cultures, putting on a joint cultural festival honoring the mutual influence of two groups on each other over many centuries. What could help address substantive difficulties? An agreement might be reached to settle issues temporarily and then put off into the future the final settlement. These are just examples. Think about what would work in the conflicts you know best, and explore the other frameworks in the resources section. Consider, for example, the very simple question, what's up? Who cares? So what? Those very simple questions remind us to think about all the people who care about a conflict. For example, with the Georgians and South Ossetians, there are also Russians who care deeply, and Americans and Western Europeans too. That gives a broader perspective on the conflict. There are also some highly developed frameworks that would take more time than this lecture to explain. For example, in the resources section, the conflict assessment framework offered by USAID. It appears in the document Conflict Assessment Framework 2.0. That framework is explained in detail in a USAID document linked on the resources page, Conflict Assessment Framework Application Guide. That framework focuses on context, identity groups, institutional performance, economic aspects, social aspects, societal patterns, key mobilizers, and trajectories. That framework is designed for assessing conflicts to inform constructive development support to conflict areas. Get to know these frameworks and choose to use ones appropriate for your context. It is important to realize conflict resolution is something each of us have some experience with. Think about the conflicts you are involved in. Maybe you've argued with a brother or sister or neighbor or someone at your workplace or school. Maybe your government is waging a war far away around the world. Maybe you've lost family to war or the after effects of war, or been wounded yourself. Maybe you have fought yourself. Or maybe the conflict you're closest to is not a violent one. Maybe your community is divided over a difficult decision. How to handle the refuse when the current town dump is too full? Should a new dump be built? Should the town trash be sent to a neighboring area? What would those people think of it? Conflict prevention can be engaged to work on such issues before they become matters of life and death, issues that people will struggle bitterly against each other to address. Conflict analysis is a very useful part of conflict resolution practice. Practice analyzing the conflicts you know. Next time, we'll focus more on conflict resolution practice.